So, yes, seven names booked, one more left to go. We have Teray versus Yo It's Flo as our eighth game. Teray, fairly simplistic route to get here, went through the upper bracket, lost on stream to Abar, now has his second chance, whereas Yo It's Flo has had a bit of a marathon on his hands, honestly. Went down into the lower bracket quite early. We didn't actually have room to fit his entire run on the board. There's actually another game that he did not get to play here, but he's taken out some big names on the way. Amnesiac, Tap both going down at his hands. So we will see if he can pull out one more win or whether it's going to be Teray that's going to complete our lineup after this grueling season of Hearthstone. We have one more game to cover, and covering it for you at the desk are TJ and Admirable.
Thank you very much, Shuttle. That's right. My name is TJ, and I'm joined by That's Admirable. And Admirable, it's the last match of the day, and I can tell you I've never been more ready for some Hearthstone.
And same on this one. Yo, it's Flo, the last representative that's in the running for the caster picks. He was my pick in particular to take this event down, and his decks are looking pretty cool for this last one on camera. Really excited to see how they pan out.
Yeah. Also, high stakes for everything. This is the last chance that both of these players have to qualify for the World Championship since they're not in the running for last call. Also, it's the last chance that any of the casters of all of the summer preliminary have a chance at getting a pick into the championship with Admirable having its flow on the board. Admirable, the stakes could never be higher.
Yeah, and you pretty much set the stage there as being the last representative for it, and this being their last chance. I mean, the pinnacle of Hearthstone competition is to make it to the World Championship. If they're going to do it, it's going to take a win here and then three more at that championship. So this match here, it's the catalyst to that spot. Every player so far has three more matches to win if they want to become a champion. But for these two, it's four, and it starts right here.
And Teray, a lot of people forget about it, but Teray's already been to a world championship.
That's
he
right.
was at BlizzCon in 2014. So this is his chance to maybe get back to another one, or at least get back to another championship. And Flo's been sort of the guy that's always behind the scenes for a lot of top players, including Chalky. And he's a guy that always has sort of a mastermind for deck lists, but a lot of people have never really heard of him. I made him as a pick in spring prelims. I actually made the same exact picks as you did, Nossum and Yo It's Flo, and he didn't do so well, but this might be his time to shine.
Yeah, taking a look at these deck lists real quick. This is a classic C'Thun Warrior Control deck that Teray is running with. He's got a copy of Gorehowl, Doomcaller, and Sylvanas Windrunner here alongside Justicar and a couple of Brawls. And his early game has been changed just a little bit. It does have two Beckoner of Evils, one Acolyte of Pain, two copies of Bash, one copy of C'Thun's Chosen. Yo, It's Flow deck is a deck that we've seen on stream already during this broadcast. Chalky is running the exact same list, and he has named it Yogg Not Tempo, and it features two copies of Firelands Portal and a slew of removal spells alongside Forgotten Torch.
Yeah, right off the bat, Flow with the patience to not play the Sorcerer's Apprentice. This ends up becoming sort of a value matchup because you know that it's very likely a warrior is going to kill your Sorcerer's Apprentice on turn two before you get value out of it, whether it be the Coin of Disciple of C'Thun or Fireworks it down. It's not really living through the next turn. So like the patience by Flo to hold on to it and wait till he's going to be able to get some value out of it, or at least wait until killing it becomes an awkward turn for Teray.
Yep, and that's really something that's been so strong about Flo throughout his career is understanding his win conditions and matchups. He can identify them before the game starts. He's able to adjust his game plan based on the tools that he draws. He just really hasn't had one huge finish to cement himself as a very strong player. But like you said, working a lot behind the scenes, he kind of comes up with the core deck that drives a lot of the lineups that players like Chalky, Nostum, and Muzzy play.
Including the Temple Mage, which a lot of them did play. This is Flo's creation. It's not anything too outside the box, just a pretty much Flamestrike cut added in the Firelands portal, but bold choice when it's a new card, not much testing.
Moving over to the Acolytes of Pain, the Forgotten Torches as well, gives the deck a very different dynamic than it had before, where you're able to kind of play a value game versus some of the matchups that you were not able to do that against prior to Firelands portal.
Yeah. So a couple options here for Teray. He can just shield slam it, throw down a Beckoner of Evil and armor up. I mean, that seems like the obvious choice. You don't want to leave this up. He can also just bash and coin out a Disciple of C'Thun.
Yeah. Something really interesting to talk about, I think, in this spot is how Teray perceives Yo It's Flo's hand right now. I mean, he hasn't seen a Mana Worm. He hasn't seen a Cult Sorcerer. He hasn't seen a Sorcerer's Apprentice. There's been no Mirror Image. like, what's the hand for Flo is what I think Teray's is wondering right now. And so because of that, just choosing to make very safe plays, try to get that C'Thun development while he can and look towards some more powerful plays later on.
Yeah. All right, well, Flo going to go for a big board build-up here. Does take out that Fechner of Evil. It was very, very likely that he was to do that. And this is sort of what you need to do in this deck. You need to make a big push, and you need to try and protect those key minions with the Flame Waker and the Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yep.
He threw it the last one to make a check for removal. And also, since he had to, he wanted to try and make Teray not be developing something and actually have to remove that off the board.
What?
So
no.
Yeah, combinations of cards with this mage deck is really going to be the plan here.
I have no
if you couple together a big chain of spells, that's a way that you can find a favorable position. And until then, it's really tough. That is a
lot of
burn in hand. 12, 17, 18, 19. There's 20 just out of hand for Flo right now. So if he connects for 5 with these two minions and drops Firelands Portal, I mean, this could be end up being a game-winning card. The problem with this is that Teray just played Sylvanas and is on 32 right now. If Flo runs into a brawl, he could just lose the game.
Also, keep in mind that he is at C'Thun 10-10, I believe, since both Beckoner Beebles were played. I think that's correct. I believe we saw 2. And so he doesn't want to run into a potential Ancient Shieldbearer as well. But that's a lot of damage to forego.
Yep, he's looking like it's just, well, I mean, we're going for it is what it looks like at this point. And I can tell you, he doesn't want too many of these hits to go to the Sylvanas. And I'm thinking hero power is on the menu here, but I don't think Frostbolt's too bad either. Giddy up. Yo, it's Flo is going straight to the dome. And that Sylvanas at 1,
yeah.
He wants that damage. He wanted all that damage to go to the face. If that had happened, Teray would be at 6. Instead, he's at 10. So probably fairly safe here. But when you see that much damage get launched, you have to be sitting there going, nah. What can he draw? Like, what's the worst thing he could see right now? So removing Flamebreaker will be priority. Bash on the Sorcerer's Apprentice. Damage is shut down for the time being. But now how valuable is the ping onto the Sylvanas at this point? You can ping the Sylvanas, set up the Firelands Portal. Oh, we can't do that anymore. You'd have to rip the missiles to do that. Uh-oh. Yep, he's trying to get that Firelands Portal down. I was still considering it on 6 because of the Sorcerer's Apprentice, which is no longer in play, so.
Yeah. What's it going to be? Psychotron.
Not too terribly bad, but we're about to run into Justicar, Ancient Shieldbearers, Twin Emperor Veklor. I think Teray is going to very easily climb out of this initial assault here from Yowitz Flo.
Yeah.
Didn't have the card draw to back up the rest of what he had. Was missing those Acolytes of Pain, those Arcane Intellects, the Azure Drakes.
To be honest, this feels like a really tough matchup where you have to sort of play aggressive. Traditional control warrior sometimes struggles against Temple Mage just because they don't have sort of the threats that they can play that forces Temple Mage to actually use removal spells early. But this deck has so much stabilization. I mean, yeah, he's sort of drawn into it a lot earlier than normally would be on turn 8, but still, he got that activation down, and now he has so many great options at his disposal. It's just like, which one makes him lose the least percentage of the time? All of them make him lose a very little amount, but this one seems like it's going to be the best option.
Yeah, we are looking at the draw Yogg plan for Yowitz Flo right now.
Not only draw Yogg plan, but by the time he gets Yogg, imagine just how much armor Teray's going to have.
Right. I'm curious if Yowitz Flo, if his best win condition was quite literally to just go for the damage, because had he just taken it a little bit slower and just held on to Flamewakers and tried to get like a big double Flamewaker turn, sure, Teray would have been in a lot of armor, but maybe you could have bought yourself a lot of time by killing minions along the way, just by putting Teray in weird positions where you're not really doing anything, so Teray eventually has to expend a resource, also kind of doing nothing. And that's also a brand to go alongside that Twin Emperor at this point. So things are going to get worse for Yowitz Flo as this moves on.
He can get closer. Acolyte of Pain's going to get him closer to the Yogg Yogg-Saron.
Yeah, it is Yogg-Saron or bust, I think, for Yotsla at this point. At 21 armor for Teray, there's no way he's going to bust this by using 3 and 6 damage spells.
Yeah, and you could... We said it earlier. The name of Flo's deck is Yogg, not Tempo. This isn't Tempo Mage.
Yeah, this is Yogg Mage.
This is Yogg Mage.
Everyone says Yogg Druid,
but nobody says Yogg Mage.
Yeah.
And I think Mage gets behind more than Druid does.
Very wise to execute here from Teray. Deny card draws from Yowit's Flo. He understands that Yogg-Saron is the win condition right now, and just continue to build the armor total and hope to fade it.
Oh, there he is. Right on time.
That's a big one. I think I want to say it's 12. I think I counted. Okay, Hex Yogg-Saron.
It has charge. It's green. Oh, no, you can play it again. That's why.
Well, that's not the right order, Yogg. That is pretty much the worst order. He needs massive card draw from Yogg-Saron right now, not to backstab his own Mastiffs.
All right, this so far is winning the... Oh, okay, never mind. Well,
that helps. Ice block, no consequence, flash heal, nothing happening, and that is about the worst Yogg-Saron I could have imagined for Flo, and that will end the game. There is no longer a major win condition left in the build.
Who knows what secrets will unlock?
Ouch.
The Feast of Souls.
Now, I wonder if there's an argument for waiting just a little bit longer on the Yogg-Saron since you're under zero pressure, really.
You also know your opponent just doesn't have many cards. If you're going to get a good Yogg, I think you're going to get a good Yogg. And I think going for it earlier has a bigger chance of you being able to develop a board that's tough to kill and then getting in for enough damage to where you win the game.
I mean, there's a lot of merit to that, but you also have to consider there is still 2 Arcane Elects and 2 Azure Drakes in the build. So if you draw any of those cards, you're usually... Frog-Saron does not have the same come-into-play effect that that Yogg-Saron does.
He casts a random Ribbit. For every Ribbit that he's cast so far that game.
And if you couldn't tell from the board position, Teray is basically going to win this one. Now that the Justicars hit as well, we will begin to tank up and amassing a giant steel bunker around Garrosh's face.
You can just imagine sort of Garrosh putting more armor on himself.
Just stacking it on.
And Justicar Chuhart comes into town.
Another breastplate.
Well, that was a pretty tough matchup, I think, for Flo. A lot of his decks struggle against C'Thun Warrior. He banned the Warlock, I think, because his decks struggle against Warlock as well.
Yes.
So it's like, which one do I want to leave up? That's going to be a bad matchup. And I think Temple Mage has the chance to just blow out Warrior a lot more than it has a chance to just blow out Zoo Warlock.
Yes.
Since their curve is so low. So I think that's why he left it up. Now that it's out of the way, though, he's got a little bit of interesting things on his hands. And I don't know. It's going to be tough.
So he's fighting off the Midrange Hunter from Teray, I guess it's sort of a Midrange Hunter. It's got some really interesting choices. So there's 2 copies of Explosive Traps. There's the copy of Dreadscale that's in the build as well. And that gives, and there's also 2 copies of Kodo in the 5-drop slot. It's a really interesting dynamic that you're looking at, because Teray has kind of said that he's willing to fight against the aggro decks a lot harder with this and be weaker versus control. And if you look at Flo's lineup, that's almost exactly where it lies, aside from the Druid build. There's more aggro versions. The Druid build has a copy of Ragnaros in it, which has historically been very powerful versus Hunter. And so the Hunter matchup, I think, is a little bit of concern for Flo at this point, just simply because it has so much stuff to fight against the going wide on the board plan.
Yeah, definitely does. And the deck is... I thought the deck was really interesting because Hunters haven't really gone for a game plan that doesn't revolve around trying to stick stuff on the board early on, and it's sort of what Teray has. Double Explosive Trap means he's sort of conceding the early game, and also his early game is like situational. He's got double King Zealot instead of Huge Toad, which means he's trying to play for the late game because he's trying to get those draws, and he also runs double Knife Juggler, which Knife Juggler is just not good by itself, but it's great with Unleash the Hounds against those faster decks.
Right, so the game plan here for Yotz Flo as we roll into the Hunter versus Shaman matchup is more of a singular threat kind of plan where you want to get one thing on the board and have it get value. And that's very difficult to do when your opponent's got Quick Shots and Animal Companions and Eagle Horn Bows.
Deadly Shot.
Yeah, it's hard to stick one thing to the board and get a lot of value from it. You typically have to go wide on the board. So it's almost like one of those damned if you do, damned if you don't sort of situations where Flo just, a better game plan is usually to hope your opponent doesn't draw those cards.
Yeah.
You're likely to see Flo take what looks like a lot of risks, I'd say, in the game.
Yeah, I think aggressively themed shamans sort of need to take these types of risks in order to win a lot of matchups. There are some pretty poor matchups, like Zoo in this matchup. Gets a healing totem. I feel like we've seen a lot of healing totems today. Admirable, I'm suspicious.
It's here to soothe the players as they don't get the right rolls they need. It's there.
Yeah.
We'll heal those wounds.
We'll heal you.
And so Flame Tongue Totem normally would be a pretty significant draw here, but against the Leok, you kind of feel bad using a 3-2 plus a trade-up to take out a Leok.
Yeah.
It's still the same card that an animal could, like, it's just one card. It's an animal companion.
If it was a Misha, you would have done the same thing without hesitation.
Yeah, if this is Misha, you just snap to it. Now in this situation, though, it looks like he's actually going to get used from the Healing Totem. Keep that 5-2 around and try to push a bit. And so Teray's hand does operate very nicely versus this, but Flame Wreath Faceless is coming soon. And if that ends up lining up against where there's no Deadly Shot, it ends up being a game winner. And Yoetz Flo knows there's only one copy of Deadly Shot in Teray's build,
yeah,
but it happens to be in his hand.
And if that's the case, Teray is almost 100% going to equip Eaglehorn Bow here, because that means he guarantees to isolate the Flame Wreath Faceless if it comes out on 4. And he has to realize that that's one of the ways that Yoetz Flo actually wins this matchup, but he goes with Infested Wolf instead.
Yeah, this is...
This guarantees it as well, because he can still quick shot and deadly shot. So actually, this is better.
Well, it is and it isn't at the same time. I think I like building board tension more than I like using the Eaglehorn Bow, because the Eaglehorn Bow gives you a chance to just take too much damage. But in this spot, you get such a massive amount of clean trades here that you take a little bit more damage in the short term, but it buys you a lot in the long run, and you also get some board development out of it.
CEO, it's Flo sort of wince there. It's not a good sign, but one thing that he can try and do is dodge Houndmaster.
We're on one game plan right now for Flo, and it's push damage on Teray.
And that game plan is about to be interrupted by
a screeching halt. You know, like when you're looking at the yellow light and you're like, can I? Yeah, but and then eventually you decide to break.
No, Houndmaster is that pedestrian that crosses the crosswalk and stares at you as you approach. You're like, oh no! That's what Houndmaster is doing right now.
Yep, Knife Juggler alongside. This is suddenly looking very bad for Flo. Not only that, but if he kills the Infested Wolf before he kills the Knife Juggler, there's also two daggers coming from that as well.
And you can't race at this point because you don't have a health lead, really. Maybe.
We'll find out what the plan is here for Flo. I mean, it might just require drawing the perfect cards.
What are the perfect cards?
Probably just Lava Bursts.
Lightning Storm, maybe.
Right now. Yeah, Lightning Storm looking pretty good. I'm thinking that Steady Shot is likely to be the pick. It's going to be Life Tap, which I'm really surprised by that. I mean, when you're this far behind, Life Tap does not represent a great deal of comeback potential here.
Here come the knives. Not what he wanted to see.
Nope, every single minion that dies is gonna make it that much harder for Flo to push. Oh,
and call
mama.
Of the wild.
Well, I don't like to call games this early, but I believe this is going to be 2-0. For Teray at this point.
These have been both just kind of brutal games for Flo. I mean, now after these two, he's going to have to win 3 in a row against the last deck from Teray, which I believe is Druid. I feel like we've seen Druid in that situation a lot today, and it's failed sometimes.
Yes, Druid is kind of the pinpoint target for Flo's deck. Now, ideally, you do pick up a win or two along the way,
yeah.
Because the matchups are not unwinnable, they're just not great. And so now he's found himself in this situation. The not tempo Yogg Mage deck, as he's decided to name it, is pretty strong versus Druid. The Ragnaros
Shaman
with Druid, you have an extra win condition in the deck, and then the Aggro Shaman can perform as well. So he has to win 3 straight, but that's it. I mean, this is his last chance to make it here. Teray has just absolutely blasted through the first two games. Not even close.
Not even close. Trey's had some close calls over the past couple of days, as I believe he's had three matches featured on stream. Three matches featured on stream, including the one earlier, which was a decider match that he did lose to A-Bar. And now Flo, of course, going to go ahead and concede being at six health, but it's down to match point for Teray. One more game, and he's back at a championship. Took him 2 years to get back, but he did it. Or he might do it.
Yeah, he might do it here. I mean, he's one game away at this point. But the Druid, like you said, Druid is a deck that we've seen either just completely run away with the game or really struggle to close the series. There's been very little in between, I'd say, from Druid.
But three opportunities to draw Innervate, Violet Teacher, Power of the Wild.
Yeah, he needs Innervate versus the Shaman. He needs Wild Growth versus the Druid and the Mage decks, and then to follow up afterwards. You know, you want the consistent heavy pressure versus the Mage and the Druid. You want the bursting onto the board potential versus the Shaman to recover their aggressive push. And with three tries at that, it's a pretty good chance one of those situations will occur. And when one of those situations occur, the Druid is typically favored. So we're leading off with Shaman versus Druid, and there's that Innervate.
I see an Innervate, Admirable.
Well, I also see a Tunnel Trog, a Totem Golem, and a Flame Tongue Totem, and that's a fantastic start versus Druid as well. So we are likely to see some fireworks in this one.
A Barn Burner.
That's literally the only, that was my second pick for terms I was going to choose.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome, America.
Well, two Agitrakes and a Mulch. Was that Mulch kept?
It had to have been, because it's the only Mulch in his deck. He really wants to answer Flame Refaces because he realizes that's the only card that's going to beat him.
Well, we'll see about that. This is going to be, like I said, a very, very tough start for him. And if you're spending your turn mulching while your opponents are spending their turns, you know,
beating you up.
Yeah, it's a tough situation. So the Innervate coin, Azure Drake is going to attempt to recover this board state. Flame Tongue Totem is going to find a trade and deal a little bit of damage. And then we'll see what happens afterwards. Teray, if he continues to draw some early game spells that can help him fight through this, might be able to take this one down.
We shall see. But this Raven Idol is probably going to be crucial. If he draws a Wrath or can pick up a Wrath to deal with this Flame Tongue Totem, he's going to block a lot of damage, considering Flo does have Argent Horse Rider.
Well, there's another Innervate. So could Innervate the Fandral, but that's incredibly weak onto this board. Will Innervate Fandral?
That was a snap call.
Wow.
It's dead on the board.
Yeah, I don't know about this, TJ.
It's like they just challenge each other to play really fast. Hey, man, you play fast, I'll play fast too. Okay.
You got it.
You got it. Let's go.
Let's talk really fast as well. If you talk really fast, I'll talk really fast.
Okay, let's do it. Mulch going to come out on the Flame Refaces.
I'll tell you what, Tuskar Totemic is a great lead onto this, and now I don't think that Flo would mind the Healing Totem as much. Of course, it's Spell Power Totem. Nobody likes you, Spell Power Totem.
Jeez, Healing Totem. Picks up the Wrath.
Pulls four damage off the board.
Did he Power the Wild instead of?
Teray is playing this game very interestingly. I mean, this is going to result in six more damage. Oh, mama, that is going to be a closer, I think. Flo picks up a huge draw with Flame Wreath Faceless.
He's going to Lightning Bolt down this Power of the Wild. I bet he's wishing he'd Hero Powered. And now, there's no way back. I mean, yeah. Does he have Lethal Representative on board next turn? That's 10, 14. He does. Teray needs
a miracle.
Mulch?
I mean, even Mulch. Again? It's still seven damage he's taking in the event of Mulch. Bite can not kill the Flame Wreath Faceless, and that being unchecked.
Just bite his face? What is this, Florida?
Wow, that was.
Don't you remember that story?
Oh, I remember that guy.
Okay. I'm not, that was, that that came off a little aggressive to Floridians.
Yeah, that's what, that was.
I sincerely apologize to anybody that might have been offended, but there was a story where a man bit another man's face in Florida that went on national news. Just to clarify, it was bath salts, yeah. No
Dude,
bath salts
biting his
in this
face.
Game.
What is he on, bath salts?
Yeah, there's a good one. That's a better one. That's a better one. We'll go with that one next time.
Yep, so that's going to do it. The cavalry has arrived, and Flo puts himself on the board. 2-1 series at this point. Teray does find the Innervate, but is lacking in other removal options such as Wrath, Swipe, Living Roots just really wasn't there for him.
Yeah. So that's a good momentum swing for Flo. And Trey, he's whipping out his cards.
Yes, and playing very fast. And that's something that's really unique to talk about here, too, is Teray kind of tends to be a bit of a slower player, but I know that he's playing with the pace of the match right now. Him and Flo are very familiar with each other, and I think this is like the moment really getting caught up for both players. Flo traditionally plays pretty fast, and normally I like to criticize people with that, and I still will criticize Flo for playing quicker than he probably should. But if it's going to speed up Teray, that could be to Flo's benefit. He's very used to this kind of pace, and Teray tends to be more mindful.
You asked for it.
Very true. All right. Well, Flo goes ahead and pitches away his whole hand. One of those matchups where you don't want Arcane Blast, but he gets it right back.
Well, it's not the worst here because the Cult Sorcery, I think he's liable to hold on to Cult Sorcery until he can combo that on like an Azure Drake or maybe use it alongside a Hero Power to take out a Violet Teacher. But normally you want to be aggressive in this matchup, like getting going with a Mana Worm and just powering out threats. But that's not a very strong opener from Teray. And we're looking at Raven Idol needing to pick up something very important if he's going to get this going.
Wild Growth or Innervate are going to be crucial. Does pick up the Innervate, and I can imagine that'll be an automatic pick, and it is.
Yeah, Flo going to continue to take this patiently. It's in the makings of a reasonable hand. And this is going to come down to a lot of whether or not Teray chooses to play Azure Drake or the Druid of the Claw. I can really see him innervating the Azure Drake to try to dig for something else, which will run into the Cult Sorcerer and Arcane Blast. And if he chooses to go with Druid of the Claw, it ends up being just a little bit worse versus like Fireball. So this is going to be a really interesting spot. And now that the Cult Sorcerer has just been played, I mean, you might just be looking at charge the Druid of the Claw as well. I don't think it's like the worst option, but
I think he probably wants more options, especially judging by Teray's play so far, because right now he doesn't have much.
Well, we're nourishing for mana. And with two Ancients of War in hand, I think this is really smart too. Just being able to unlock the potential of those Ancients of War before Yoetzlo has built to a strong hand or built to the right mana total to handle that effectively is a very, very strong line of play right now, I think.
Yeah, and Flo,
that's a good draw.
Flo, once again, just playing really fast. Mirror Image can buy him a lot of time. And time is what he needs right now. Time and, Emperor Thorsen.
Wow, that draw's pretty sick. Now, it will get countered by what's on board and the Arcane Blast from Flo. But Emperor Thorsen's providing a massive discount, which allows him to roll into turn 6 with Ancient of War, and then in turn 7 with Azure Drake and Druid of the Claw, if he pleases.
Yeah. So, really crucial that Flo, to deal with these big threats, going to need to pick up some more burn, and Forgotten Torch is that.
Yep, every piece of burn, very important right now.
And Flo might think he needs to play that Forgotten Torch now to have more mana available, but another thing he needs to note is that Cold Sorcerer isn't going to live forever. He's not going to have that spell power effect forever.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is Arcane Blast, like 100% here. I think the debate is whether or not you actually ping your own Acolyte and attack with it, or whether or not you develop an Acolyte alongside of this and relegate yourself to one draw. Just going to continue digging. Well, now, honestly, Frostbolt has a lot of merit here because Blood Mage coupled with the Arcane Blast is a lot more. I mean, that suddenly it's 1 mana 6 damage, which is a much bigger swing.
Yeah.
Actually just take out this Ancient of War with Arcane Blast and a Hero Power and the Cult Sorcerer. This is a very strong turn from Flo, but there's plenty more where that came from for Teray.
Yeah, he's got all of his big boys in his hand. Can the Tempo Mage stand up to it? You build something, you kill something. That's sort of the motto of Flo's deck right now, but I don't know if he's going to be able to withstand Ancient of War.
That's a lot of heat.
Oh, yikes.
And Cenarius added to it.
This is everything. Oh, man. And he's even going to be able to Hero Power down this Blood Mage, so I think Flo is going to have to Azure Drake into Mirror Image, try and buy enough time.
Look at the pressure coming to Flo at this point, too. I mean, he cringed when he saw that second Ancient of War come down. He knows that a lot of burn is being expended at this point. Sorcerer's Apprentice enables the Mana Worm, the Arcane Intellect, and the Mirror Image with potentially a spell that he could draw. Mirror Image needs to protect these minions on board right now. These are incredibly valuable and has Flamewaker to go along with it. This game is fireworks so far.
But Teray, look, he's got double Druid of the Claw charge. He can charge those in. Okay, no, he can't. I figured he'd want to take out one of these minions.
Well, again, the speed of play is definitely something to pay attention to right now. If Teray would have thought about this turn, he would have been able to consider what double Druid of the Claw looked like.
Double Druid of the Claw and kill one of those minions.
I mean that looks like a very strong line to me.
Maybe he wants to keep those minions alive, but there's no Flame Strike in this deck, so he can't be punished in that regard. He's getting rid of one of these minions right off the bat and developing two creatures. This is what you want to do against Temple Mage. You want to sort of get out of their reach very quickly with spells. And now he's going to go with a halfway play, but this means he kills nothing.
Well, oh mama, this is a tough turn for Flo. Flame Waker is looking awfully appealing. The Firelands Portal is presenting massive value right now. I mean, I got to believe that Portal is on the menu here.
You can, oh.
Oh, he's got something in mind, so let's see where this ends up leading. The Mana Worm is going to get to a fairly large power at this point. We're looking at some trades are definitely coming this turn.
Well, he can get a ping onto this and make a trade.
Yeah, one of the problems is he doesn't actually get down the Acolyte of Pain this turn. He was hoping that he didn't have to actually use the hero power. But now that he's behind three mirror images, he's bought himself a lot of time to get to this point. And Cenarius doesn't look so good when your opponent has a protected Flame Waker on board.
Yeah, maybe I would have even liked to see him trade in the Mana Worm last turn. But I think what he figured was Teray would have killed one of his minions with the Wrath if he had it. So he thinks, well, if I can sort of get another tempo spell going here, maybe I can just leave it alive, get a little greedy, and try and trade up even more so into this Ancient of War.
The other thing to consider is if the removal spell is swipe instead, what ends up happening, like say just draw a swipe. What ends up happening now is Teray has to decide, do I swipe the Flame Waker or do I swipe the 5-3 Mana Worm while my opponent has three cards in hand? And he's going to draw a fourth and have eight mana. That's a terrifying Mana Worm right now. So if he only has one removal spell, he has to pick which one is the higher priority.
It's a great point. Great point. So probably going to see a Wrath onto the Mana Worm and a Druid of the Claw.
It is scary to not kill a Flame Waker. That is a terrifying proposition. It's going to be Mire Keeper into Druid of the Claw, like you said. And so Flo looking for a big pickup, and he needs it right here.
Arcane Missiles is pretty good.
So Firelands Portal, I think, is coming first to see what the drop is. Could get an Azure Drake potentially off that, maybe grab another spell power.
Firelands Portal onto the Druid of the Claw. He wants to try and isolate this Ancient of War. And next to Champion Sarad.
Champion Sarad. That is a huge pickup. Not only has the portal dealt 5 damage, made a 4-5, but it's also presented some board pressure and a card advantage engine.
Let's see what he gets. Quick shot.
Oh my gosh, this could be huge. Teray still cannot deal with the mirror images, by the way. Finally can take out the Flame Waker or the Nexus Champion Sarad. But once again, he has to leave up either Nexus Champion Sarad or a Flame Waker here. This is the second turn in a row this has happened.
I think he's got to take out this Flame Waker, but now he's out of cards completely.
Well, he's innervating the Cenarius as well. Yowitz Flo has been weathering the storm the entire time. Can Nexus Champion Sarad find the necessary spells to take this on?
Another Firelands Portal!
What a huge draw for Flo right now.
Holy moly.
TJ, I cannot believe this is real. I wonder if he should Hero Power first to see what he could get from the Sarad. I don't really know what the sequencing would be on that. I think you have to take care of board presence here.
That's a huge amount of card advantage that Flo's going to have. And now he's going to think about these trades.
Yeah,
and he realizes this is now a value game. So he goes ahead and makes a trade instead of pushing face.
And swipe gets drawn. I mean, that's something. But Teray needed the swipe like 4 turns ago.
Yeah.
This is the stage where Teray wants to draw his Yogg-Saron, his other Ancients of War, and Druid of the Claws. They're all dead.
Yeah. This is a board clear, but his Cenarius is going to get damaged, and he'll have 0 cards remaining with Flo having
4 card draw availability in hand.
All right, well, there it is.
Flo,
that's his stuff.
Flo had a wonderful order of operations this game to find himself at what I would consider a massive advantage right now. This is huge.
Sorcerer's Apprentice and Ancestral Knowledge. She's going to try and pick up a cheap spell to kill this, either Arcane Blast or Frostbolt. Forgotten Torch also has two mana.
What another big pickup. Now two Roaring Torches.
Did he turn the corner,
the
Admirable?
As well? I think he did. I mean, look at the hand, and look at what Teray has. Teray is on Yawgr Bust right now.
He's got a Wrath for one. He's got to cycle through this deck. He can kill it with the Hero Power, but he's also starting to run out of health. There's two Roaring Torches in the deck.
And that's not a good draw right now. Yo, it's just giving Flo more time to pull ahead.
We do have to factor in the two overload. That might make this turn a little bit weirder.
Oh my, that Flame Waker. There is a lot of gas left in the build.
Arcane Blast
to answer the Mire Keeper, and the damage push begins. Teray with a single 2-2 and no cards in hand.
This needs to beat Yogg if he wants a chance, and well, Wild Growth is not going to do it for him because he's only going to have 8 mana.
It takes a turn to get Yogg now, too. I mean, even if he drew Yogg, he couldn't cast it this turn. Another swipe.
But if he swipes, it means he can't clear the board, or
he's giving up
he has to give two cards.
Oh my gosh. I don't think Teray can win unless he literally draws Yogg next turn.
And he has to get the best Yogg ever because Flo has two Roaring Torches left. He's got so much burn. He's got so much burn left in his deck.
Another Arcane. just in case you didn't have enough card draw, there's a Roaring Torch.
That's it.
And that's going to do it. Flame Waker will add the damage necessary. And Flo has brought it to force game number 5.
And the momentum is in his favor. Teray, a couple of turns there. Well, I'm thinking maybe something better there if you take a little bit longer. It's hard to even say. They might have been the right plays, but he didn't give himself enough time to think about it, maybe.
Honestly, when you mentioned charging Druids of the Claw, that's a really big piece of information there. He can trade 2 health and the taunt on the Druid of the Claw to line up a kill with the Ancient of War that's attacking already. He could have killed a minion. And the entire game, he struggled to kill one of two priority minions. The entire time, he needed to take out the Manowarm and the Flame Waker. Then it was the Nexus Sirad and the Flame Waker. And then eventually, Flo had drawn so many cards and killed so many minions, there was just nothing left in Teray's deck.
Yeah. And now it comes down to a good old-fashioned showdown. It's Yoett's Flo's Druid versus Teray's Druid. And I gotta give this one to Flo based off of his techs. He's got Sylvanas and Rag in his deck, which means his late game is much more potent.
Yes, I would tend to agree with you, but to me the more telling thing is that Teray has a copy of Innervate, Flo has a copy of Wild Growth. Innervate is great when you need to power out a threat on board or power out an answer on board and make up that card advantage afterwards. The Wild Growth gives you the chance to become an aggressor in a slower matchup, and just as I say that, Teray draws Turgy Wild Growth, so throw all that analysis out the window. We have a really big game in front of us now.
Yeah.
But Teray has turn 4 Emperor Thorson, and Flo does not have an answer to it.
So real quickly, because this game could ramp up very quickly, literally, let's go over the differences between the deck. Teray has double Mire Keeper, and his late game is double Ancient of War Cenarius with an Emperor Thorsan. Yoett's Flo has no Mire Keepers, so for going that potential extra ramp, and he goes with double Ancient of War Sylvanas, Rag, and Cenarius. So Sylvanas instead of Emperor Thorsan, and an extra Rag in the deck.
This game is getting crazy. And when I say getting crazy, I mean these hands are... there's going to be so much board tension over the next 2 turns that I just honestly don't know how this is going to pan out. This is
my
tough one to call.
My brain is overloaded right now for 7.
You didn't even play a Flame Wreath Faceless.
Yeah, this matchup, if it were a card, it'd be given a tense match, overload TJ for 7.
The land well, serves. Power of the Wild's a good one too. Teray has pieced together a lot of damage, and Flo, normally that Sylvanas would be a big tiebreaker here, but the pressure is just going to pour on top of this. Flo is in a lot of trouble here. Big draw on that mulch.
Pay attention, class.
Won't go with the Sylvanas here. I don't know if that's right, TJ.
Yeah, this does challenge the board, sort of. It Master's not really that great. The 1-1s can do a lot. And he can just ramp into Rag next turn if he feels like that's going to be a good option.
I think that's where the game plan was for this. So the mulch means that Teray's going to be playing oftentimes one threat here. When that happens, wants to roll into the Ragnaros, but the Ragnaros isn't very strong when your opponent has four ones sitting on the board and a 5/10 on board as well.
Yeah.
You know, Flo, I think, really needed to think about what Sylvanas meant this turn. You know, looking at it, taking an extra 6 damage and not getting the Violet Teacher out is probably a bit aggressive.
Yeah.
But it still needs to consider, like, what all the situations look like. I mean, Sylvanas maybe in some niche situation is just a better play.
Flo's got to be pretty happy to see that that's a Living Roots for damage and not for tokens, because both of his power plays at the moment
I think
are dependent on not having small minions to hit or steal.
See, this is the other problem too, is if in the face of Ancient of War, where do you actually win the game now? I mean, you just mulched. So now Sylvanas isn't on board, you don't have mulch, you can't steal a minion. Teray is gonna trade it up here though.
Also, that's just a lot of damage on the board.
Wow, Living Roots is a very important pickup. I mean, it's got to be Sylvanas here. There's no other option, and that Living Roots has to cut in before the damage here. Well, Flo, this is now Flo's win condition, is steal a big minion and hope things go right.
Wow.
Yeah, it runs in the one there in case of the event he draws something valuable to actually take this out with. Druid of the Claw gets drawn. 5, 9, 10, 11, 12 damage. 13 total available for Teray, but is he willing to push that much damage into this board position?
I don't know. This is incredibly intense. I mean, Teray might feel like with his resources right now, he has to go on the aggressive and just sort of ignore it. But Inmaster presents an interesting situation where Sylvanas could steal something just bad.
Yes, and that's I think it's exactly what Teray is looking at right now, is if I play Inmaster, what's the likelihood that Flo just doesn't get a good minion?
Yeah, also, Teray had an opportunity to play a free Wild Growth last turn. What? In a situation where he would have been able to play both. I know it's a tough thing to say, but...
Well, giddy up.
Oh, wow.
Here we go. Teray says, we're going to find out if your steals are good enough. Flo needs some help. He's down to 9. He's got Sylvanas. He's got Fandral and Druid of the Claw.
So you want a Fandral and Druid of the Claw
after the steal. So what did he take?
Oh, he got the Druid of the Claw.
Whoa, this is big,
TJ. Clear.
That's a full clear. Fandral sticking and Ragnaros is in hand.
And he's got so much more resource advantage with Rag and Azure Drake.
He's at 9, though. Is 9 enough life? Azure Drake is a big draw right now to get him extra cards. There's a Druid of the Claw.
A morning person.
This is, Flo's not out of this yet. He's still got some work to do.
Oh,
this is, I think he's just gonna rag, honestly, but this feels very dangerous. Señor del Fuego is gonna hit the board. Flo's gonna roll the dice. We're gonna find out if Rag has got what it takes to end this board position.
I mean, if this, so Teray has a Druid of the Call, which is 4 damage. Hero power is 5 damage. A swipe off the top would be lethal regardless.
Goes to face. I don't know what's the, oh my gosh, that's a huge draw.
This is just back-to-back big boys.
Flo just shakes his head. Flo needs some help of his own now. I mean, this is where he wants to draw his Ancient of War and see the standoff happen. I mean, if he draws an Ancient of War right here, it's a 10-10, and that's a big deal. I don't know if Azure Drake and Druid of the Claw is ever better in this situation. Honestly, I think Flo should have taken out the Imp Master last turn and left the 1-1 on board, used the Fandral to clear out that, because the Ragnaros now,
that could have been a big deal.
Oh!
But he doesn't...
You have to isolate the Ancient War here and hope you hit it. Like, that's the way to win right now. He cannot win if this Ancient War sticks.
Is that a higher win percentage than just going with Druid of the Claw this turn and going for Azure Drake swipe next turn?
I don't know. Wrath is something you need to consider, though. Living Roots.
The rope! I don't even know!
Power of the Wild is in the build.
I have no idea what to do.
Flo not killing that Imp Master may have come back to haunt in this game.
If this decision goes awry, and he's going to go for it.
He has to trade in the Fandral. And this is it. Ragnaros needs to connect this shot. If Flo cannot take this 5 damage, if this Rag misses, Teray is going to win the game. And that's going to do it. Teray is going to win the series 3-2 and become the 8th competitor at the America's Championship.
Wow, what a game to finish it all off. Going to game number 5. It seemed like Flo had turned the corner at the end there, but Teray gets the Ancient of War, and wow, insane.
That is such a tight game between these two as well. You know, Flo in a couple of these situations had some really sticky spots. The Sylvanas instead of the Mulch is something to take a look at. I feel like Mulch is probably superior because taking 6 damage there and giving a second discount is a lot to pay.
It is.
When I take a look at the turn where he used the Fangirl to attack face and he cleared off the 1-1 minion with the hero power, if instead he clears the Imp Master there, sure, he deals 3 less damage, but now there's not another 1-1 being made. Maybe he doesn't have to swipe that turn instead and can set up, say, Azure Drake and Druid of the Claw. A lot of little things came into play there that could make a big difference, and I think the biggest one is simply the Ragnaros missing the final shot at the end. If Flo hits that Ragnaros shot, it could be smooth sailing. Needs a little bit more time. You know, if he had drawn Yogg-Saron at that point, if he just had a Wrath for tempo a little bit earlier, a very close set. But Teray has played fantastically the entire time that we've seen him play, and it's a very strong representative for America's Championship.
Yeah, making it back to another championship. So let's take one final look here at the top 8. Those are the 8 representatives that will be coming to the America's Summer Championship in just about a few weeks' time. Topo Pablo, Monsanto, Roof Trell, and Abar, Pascoa, Dude, Hot Meowth, and now finally, Teray. I'd say I'm pretty happy with that lineup. We have a few players represented from Latin America. We have a few players who have been trying to make it for a very long time in the America scene, and we have a player who went to the World Championship in 2014, is now back to try and prove himself once again in Teray.
Yeah, plus we have 2 Latin American representatives for the first time at a big championship here.
Yeah.
And that's just everything this weekend has shaped up so wonderfully. A lot of strong play towards the end of this event especially, and just very, very much looking forward to the championship taking place.
Yeah, it was awesome to cast the last match, but we do have Frodan, who's over at the Blackboard, and I believe he has an interview ready with Teray.
We have all 8 competitors, and it is one final spot that went to a repeat performer. That's right. We have someone from the 2014 World Championship who did qualify from the Americas Regions, his second berth. We welcome Teray to the interview stage. Teray, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Hey, what's up, man? How have you been since 2014? We haven't seen you in a while.
I haven't been playing as much, but I've been kind of doing other things in life, but with all the like new cards and standard coming out, I started playing a bit more again, and I feel like it's been fun, yeah.
Awesome, that's great. What's been your motivation to come back this year? Was it something that you felt unfinished with 2014, or did you just want to climb the mountain again and challenge yourself?
With Hearthstone, I always kind of like just have fun playing, so whenever I kind of, you know, have the chance to play in a tournament or compete, I usually just try to go for it and try my best and hope to do well. So obviously the BlizzCon would be awesome. So I just came yesterday and today and did my best.
Yeah, and it worked out for you. I think a lot of people also remember you for all the Miracle Rogue and how well and proficient you were. Miracle still is very much involved in the standard metagame, although maybe not as powerful. Some people chose to bring it. Why didn't you stay loyal to the Rogue class? I thought everyone who played Rogue was super loyal to Valyria.
Yeah, that's true. You know, everyone who plays Rogue, you know, like Hyped, Dog, and all those other players, they always keep playing it and believing in it. But I think I just lost too much with it, so I lost hope.
Oh, no. All right. Well, maybe Karazhan can mix it up a little bit as you got to incorporate some of that into your play as well. The final question is, why don't you go ahead and thank anybody that helped you be successful get to this point, because getting to 2 championships in 2 separate years is quite the achievement, only done by a handful of people.
Yeah, first of all, huge shout out to Esports Arena and Shimonahi for being an awesome venue and God tier admin. And second of all, shout out to Magic Amy for helping me prepare my decks again and just kind of go through like the tournament overall. And another huge shout out to all my friends and my family for always supporting me and letting me keep playing, even though like I don't do so well sometimes. And then lastly, shout out to Ray, who worked really hard and was able to qualify, but unfortunately couldn't play. So yeah, hashtag decks out for Ray.
Absolutely. For people who don't know, Ray C did qualify. Unfortunately, he had to have some surgery, I believe, and he couldn't join us. But hopefully for next year and the next seasons, he can join us as he is a passionate competitor. Thank you so much to Ray, and a great amount of shout-outs. We'll see you at the championship in just a month.
Thank you.
All right, so we've had quite a journey, everybody, through all of the preliminaries across every single season. But of course, this is not just the area where we're seeing lots of great games of Hearthstone being played, but it is the Thresh floor, where we see players go in and out of predictions. And so, as with such, we have to cross out some of the names that, honestly, we were just wrong about. Well, not we. When I mean we, I mean TJ. So after a very passionate battle between two or three back-to-back mages in Arena, Crip, unfortunately, just was never lucky. So they needed precisely those two Fireland portals in order to beat him. And of course, due to too much YouTube memeing, Blizzard has finally sentenced Disguised Toast to lifetime in jail, personally by Ben Brode. But you know what? The rest of us were pretty right. As usual, ha, TJ thought he can do it, but maybe better luck's next year in 2017, TJ. As for us, we've had a lot of fun. Teray's not the only player that we predicted to get through. We also were expecting some other high-level plays, and we're really pleased with all of the rest of the talent that's made it to the top eight. So a big shout-out to the two players from Latin America. We got Topo Pablo as well as Pascoa, and of course, Dude7597 persevering despite all of the upper bracket shenanigans. Against Hot Meowth, Teray, Roof Trellin, Monsanto, and Abar. That's going to be our top eight for the America's Championship in the summer season. One of those players will be going to BlizzCon. We're done here from Frodan, the casters, and everyone else here in the production crew. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you guys in the summer.